Lawmakers are once again considering a ban on the use of corporal punishment for special needs students. Currently, corporal punishment is still permissible, but some lawmakers want to change that and some don't. Capitol correspondent Jason Doyle joins us now with more on the interim study convened this week at the Capitol. Jason.
Rich, it comes down to this. Is corporal punishment an effective tool for schools to help discipline students? Some say, spare the rod, spoil the child, while others are pointing to social science for their sides of the SWATs in school debate.
We appreciate each and every one of you being here.
On Monday, Representative Jim Olson kicked off his interim study on corporal punishment in schools to take a closer look to see if this kind of discipline is effective. From his point of view, it's still a tool necessary for teachers and administrators to keep students on the right track.
The thrust of our study is in the title, The Effectiveness of Properly Administered Corporal Punishment. Now, just to clarify what our goal is not, I have no legislation that I intend to introduce that's at all attached to this. I have no desire to insist that every parent use corporal punishment, nor that every school use corporal punishment. The goal is to leave that as an option for those schools.
While Olson has no plans for legislation, there is talk among anti-corporal punishment advocates that lawmakers will try again this year to limit the use of the disciplinary action.
I think the common perception is when you take corporal punishment away from a school as a method of discipline, that you've taken discipline out of the school. And it's not true, but the fact remains that we have to have training and supports for alternate forms of discipline, that is multi-tiered systems of supports. So yes, I would support legislation that would make mandatory training for all teachers, all schools, multi-tiered systems of supports.
To voice support for the continued use of corporal punishment in schools, Representative Olson invited a retired superintendent and an active superintendent to outline how the discipline is used in their districts.
My district did use corporal punishment when I retired, and it still does. We used it sparingly and with permission slips from parents. It wasn't our first form of discipline. We would pull the card or time out or detention. It was typically our last choice.
I'm not standing here today to tell you that the reason that we have 12 A's and the reason we're a blue ribbon school is because we spank kids all the time. That's just not the case. What I will tell you is that it is a part of a 1,000-piece puzzle that we have going on within Warner Public Schools.
According to a report by Oklahoma Appleseed Center for Law and Justice, Oklahoma ranks fifth in the nation for states using corporal punishment in schools. That same report shows 137 school districts allow for spanking students. Oklahoma's two largest school districts, Oklahoma City and Tulsa Public Schools, banned the use of corporal punishment. However, Superintendent Vinson believes just the threat of getting SWATs at school is enough reason to keep it as an option. He adds that in most cases, once a student receives SWATs, they rarely need that kind of discipline again.
That I paddled less than 15 times in 5 years of being a high school principal. And I never had a repeat student in those 5 years. Typically, a student that gets paddled doesn't get paddled again for the most part. It is effective.
Carolyn McAllister helped to organize a group of concerned parents, educators, and advocates as a response to the interim study, and feels that while corporal punishment may be limited in some schools, that is not universally the case.
I want to say it is not last resort. It just isn't. It's being used quickly and immediately, and it's used repetitively, and that ought to tell us something. Common sense would tell if you have to paddle a child over and over, it's not working as in a discipline approach. And it's certainly not teaching them how to change and why they need to change their behavior.
Representative Randy Randleman, who is a mental health professional consulting with schools on disciplinary issues, takes another view.
Discipline is not a choice if it's going to happen. It's when it's going to happen. So, and there's many types of discipline. So in all the studies that I've been through, you know, what you want is you want your child to grow up healthy, well-being, and independent.
Randleman suggests that students who face discipline should first be evaluated to get to the root cause before any kind of punishment is administered.
Before you use any kind of discipline, or before I go into a school, We're going to do a functional behavioral assessment. We're going to do a behavior plan, or we will do a psychological evaluation. Now, know this. There's 339 disorders that I can diagnose. There's 13 categories that the State Department of Education uses.
There's also the biblical point of view. Spare the rod, spoil a child.
Proverbs 19:18. Very simple. It says, chasten thy son while there is hope. Let not thy soul spare for his crying. Now, it was affirmed earlier in this study, oh, well, there's the rod. It's used for guiding the sheep. And certainly guidance is part of proper child training and child raising. But chastisement is distinct from guidance. You only get chastisement properly if you reject the guidance.
Olson understands that some do not want to administer punishment like swats in school, but he believes the outcomes are worth it.
Chastening is not joyous, but grievous. It's not pleasant. It's not pleasant to the one who receives it. Neither is it pleasant to the one that gives it. But look at this final result. Nevertheless, afterward, it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness.
Is the juice worth the squeeze? Is delivering corporal punishment that way, under those conditions, worth the benefit? None of the presenters we talked to today said they couldn't live without it. They all said they could be effective without it, but it was just a good tool they liked to have.
In the press conference after the interim study concluded, Oklahoma State University school psychology professor Gary Duhon contends that schools don't need corporal punishment to help students be successful.
Nobody said without corporal punishment, schools will fall apart. So the question is it worth it? Should we be using it?
Last year, legislation was considered to restrict the use of corporal punishment on a wider set of students with disabilities. That bill did not make it out of the House after it was amended by the Senate.